Welcome to Anchors of Truth, live from the 3ABN Worship Center. Do-It-Yourself Religion with Lee Venden.
Welcome again to Anchors of Truth. Glad that each one is here in our live audience. My name is Greg Morricone. This is my wife, Jill. We also want to say a welcome to you in our television land. Also through radio, you may be listening to this program this evening. Also on mobile devices. That seems to be quite the trend as well. We get a lot more response from people that are watching on their iPads and their iPhones, Android devices as well. But anyway, welcome to the Anchors of Truth program. What a blessing this series has been with Elder Lee Venden. I know that I've truly been blessed, and tonight is night number 3 from this series. But if you're joining us brand new maybe tonight, just real quick, Pastor Lee Venden, he comes from Upper Columbia Conference, which I call way out west from here in southern Illinois. And he is the full-time revivalist for that conference. He and his wife travel a lot together. He and his wife have been married, he told me just before we went out here on stage, for 36 years. They have 2 beautiful children, and they're so happy in serving the Lord. Now, I know we've been following this series, so tell us a little bit more about this, what this full 5-part series is all about.
It's called The Revelation of Whom. And for those of you who have been here night by night, it has been a tremendous blessing, hasn't it? And if you have joined us at home, we know it has been a blessing for you at home as well. Obviously, The Revelation of Whom focuses on looking at the book of Revelation, but yet looking at it through the eyes of Jesus, trying to find Jesus in the book of Revelation. Wednesday night, we looked at Revelation chapter 3, the counsel Jesus gives to the church of Laodicea. That's the end time church. Mm-hmm. We looked at that. Last night was the first angel's message. That was an incredible message, wasn't it, sweetie?
Absolutely.
I was so blessed by that. Who gets the glory? And my own heart was pricked. As I prayed last night and asked Jesus, Lord, show me the pride that is in my heart, because he talked about giving God the glory and not for our own selves. So it was an incredible blessing. And tonight we're looking at the second angel's message, and the title is Do It Yourself Religion. So I'm excited to hear what he's going to share, how we can see Jesus in the second angel's message.
Absolutely. And before we actually go to the music, which you're actually bringing our music to us tonight, we want to actually have a short prayer, and then you'll tell us about the song you're going to play for us. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we are so thankful. Thankful, Father, that as we're here in this live broadcast, here in Thompsonville, Illinois, just a little speck on the earth, mm-hmm. Father, somehow, I don't know how it all works, but Lord, you hear each one of our prayers.
Amen.
Lord, thank you that we can talk to you. We can talk to you on a personal, just personally, Father, as we would to a friend.
Amen.
Lord, we honor you as God. We recognize you as our Father and as our Lord, as our King, as our Redeemer. But Lord, also we're thankful for you wanting to have a personal relationship with us. We pray for a special blessing on Elder Venden as he brings us again another series or another part to this series. Lord, bless his lips. Thank you that he is being a vessel that you are able to pour your words through to us. And Father, as we hear the message, may we not just be hearers only, but doers also of what you want us to do. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. So tell us the song you're going to play for us tonight.
It's actually a medley. It's 2 songs. It's Something About That Name and Something Beautiful. And sometimes I'm just playing the piano, I'm not singing. And sometimes it's nice to know what the words are to the song. So the second part of the song, Something Beautiful, says something beautiful, something good. All my confusion, he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful out of my life.
Amen. And as soon as Jill is done playing the medley, we'll get to hear the third part to this series, Do It Yourself Religion. Amen. Thank you.
Something about that name. There really is something about that name. Name above all names. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. I'm going to bow one more time and have another prayer. Lord Jesus, I just bow just now, knowing that even though there's time and space between us, you hear this prayer, and that you are eager to supply us with an extra measure of the Holy Spirit tonight. You told us to ask. You said where two or three are gathered in your name that we should ask. And I'm asking right now. I know I need the Holy Spirit. I want to be on cruise control. And I pray for the Holy Spirit to just fill our hearts and open our minds and our ears and our eyes to what a friend we have in you and what that friendship includes and how we can live more completely for Jesus, in whose name I pray. Amen. Well, I want to start out by telling you a story about a Confederate prison, actually a prisoner in a Confederate prison camp. He was a Union soldier, and he had somehow gotten captured, and there he was in this prison camp. Somehow, I don't remember how, I just remember reading what happened next in the story. He escaped. He managed to escape. But he traveled by night because he was very deep into the Confederate territory and he didn't want to be seen, you know. And so he would travel under cover of darkness. And days passed as he traveled. And finally, he was getting kind of excited because he realized that he was almost to the Union territory and he couldn't wait to get home again. And so it was the final sort of day or two that he thought he'd have to travel at night. He was going along in the darkness in the woods, and suddenly a group of soldiers, picket soldiers, surrounded him, and the jig was up. So near and yet so far. They aimed their guns at him. They told him to put his hands on top of his head. They told him that if he did not surrender, they would shoot him on sight right there. You know, so it was two choices, surrender or be shot. He made the surrender choice. And they came in the darkness, got around him, tied his hands behind his back, and started marching him through the forest. It was getting close to dawn, and about the time they got to the prison where they were going to place him, he realized that every soldier's uniform was blue and not gray. And he suddenly discovered he had surrendered to his friends. And boy, was he happy. Was he happy. He had surrendered to his friends, and it was going to be a happy ending. Well, tonight we're going to talk about how that surrendering to Jesus and depending upon him is actually the happiest ending to the story. We've noticed last night as we took a look at the three angels' messages and began looking at them, we noticed that there is a common thread that goes through all three of the messages, much like the British Navy and their scarlet thread that goes through their rigging and their ropes. There's a common thread, and that is a thread, a warning against self-worship or self-dependence, and an invitation to a deeper life of faith instead of works, especially during the time of judgment. That's the common thread. And now tonight we're going to take a look at the second angel in Revelation 14:8, a second angel in a mystical Babylon. So in Revelation 14:8, we read, another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now, if all nations drink of her wine, that would have to include the non-Christian nations as well, wouldn't it? Right? So that would include Muslim nations. That would include Buddhist nations. That would include all nations, Christian and non-Christian. So if that's true, then Babylon would have to be something more than a uniquely defined denomination if it's going to include all nations. All right? Today we're going to discover how easily Babylon's problem can actually be our problem as well. Babylon's roots, as you know, trace back to a tower known as the Tower of Babel. The Tower of Babel was built by a fella named Nimrod, and in Genesis we find this interesting start of the story. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Therefore, it is said, like Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord, and the beginning of his kingdom was Babel. Now, this word Babel, we're used to that word in our modern day, because when we use that word, we're referring to confusion. So someone's talking too fast, or they are not enunciating, or they're slurring their words, or they're talking too quietly, and so it turns into a kind of a murmur, and we say to them, you know, slow down or speak more clearly. You're just babbling, we say. You're just babbling. I can't understand what you're saying. So this term babble comes back to the Tower of Babel, and you know the story. There in Genesis 11, Nimrod was the first king of Babylon. He actually was. And he built this Tower of Babel, and the purpose of building the Tower of Babel was to save themselves. The people wanted to save themselves. Noah's descendants, after the flood, had been told. God made a promise, and he said that he would put his bow in the sky as a symbol, the rainbow, as a symbol of his promise to never again destroy the earth with a flood. So there's the, every time I see a rainbow, I think, wow, that's his bow. His bow. It actually arches over the throne in heaven, and someday we'll get to see it, the original. So far we've been seeing some, I guess maybe you might call them the reprints. If the reprints are so good, can you imagine what the original must look like? So anyway, Noah's descendants doubted the rainbow's promise. They doubted God's promise, and they did not trust him to fulfill what he said. And so in an effort to save themselves, they built this tower. They figured, if God doesn't come through with his promise, which we're not sure we trust him on, we don't need to worry, because we're going to take care of ourselves. Well, how did God deal with the Tower of Babel? It went to the ground. They were already confused about salvation. They thought they couldn't trust God. So he confused their speech as well, and they became babblers. And as I already mentioned, that's where we got that phrase that we often use. Now, following Babel, we find Nebuchadnezzar in a city known as Babylon in 606 BC. Now, God's people are captive to a nation that symbolizes man's effort to save himself. See, it goes all the way back to the Tower of Babel, and now we have Babylon, and it is a nation that symbolizes man's effort to save himself. God's people are captive there. Now, the only thing needed to be Babylon's captive would be to be enslaved to the idea that somehow I can save myself. Whether it is getting to heaven, or whether it is in perfecting a Christ-like character, in either case, if I think I can save myself, I am enslaved to what Babylon symbolizes. Babylon's wine, then, is our presentation's title. It is Do It Yourself. And our title is Do It Yourself Religion. Nearly every false religion is based on the idea that man can save himself by his own efforts. In some way, save himself. So, do I have to belong to a particular church in order to be captive to the idea that I can depend on my own efforts? I don't have to belong to any church. Or I could belong to every church or any church and still have this tendency to depend upon myself. I pray every day that God would enable me to depend upon thee instead of depending on Lee. It's so easy to slip into self-dependence. Don't have to be belong to a particular church. Arthur Spalding, in his book, Captains of the Hosts, writes this: most professed Christians believe that they must strive to be good and do good, and that when they have done all that they can, Christ will come to their aid and help them do the rest. In this confused, now just a minute ago we said Babylon represents confusion, right? In this confused credo of salvation, partly by works and partly with auxiliary power, many people trust today. Notice he said many professed Christians. Many years ago, before I was a pastor, I taught in a Seventh-day Adventist high school, and I taught religion or Bible. And I remember we had a guest speaker come to our community who was presenting a series of religious meetings in one of the local churches. Every day he would come to our high school, and he would do a special presentation while he was in town for the young people there in the high school. And then after his presentation, he would mingle in the various classrooms and field questions and interact with the kids. So I was seated in one of the classrooms as he came in to interact with the kids. And the kids asked him some questions. They wanted to ask how they could be more victorious, how they could be overcomers, how they could get over besetting sins, problems, failures, flops, falls. They wanted to know how they could be overcomers. And they asked him, so, you know, what counsel do you have for us? How does it work? I'll never forget what he did. He went over to the board and he made a chart. I'm going to try and represent this chart for you on the screen. He said, now look at this chart. There's different heights on the chart because different people are capable of different percentages of effort towards overcoming. Some people may only be able to produce 10% of the effort. He says, now if you look at the chart, you'll notice nobody can do 100%. Nobody can get to the top. But some people have, just sort of by birth and by genetics and whatever, some people have more unction, more guts, more discipline, more whatever. And he said, now here's the deal. Everybody, whether you're a 90%er or whether you're a 10%er, you've got to do your part. And after you have put forth the effort that you're capable of, whichever level that is, then God kicks in the rest and takes it to 100%, which was the rest of his chart. So he says, you all can get to 100%. God makes up the difference. So if you're a 10%er, God's going to make up 90. If you're a 90%er, God's going to make up 10. You'll get to the 100%. But you've got to do your part if you expect God to do his. That's what he said as I listened. And I struggled with it because I noticed how confusing it seemed to be to the young people. They asked him questions like, well, how do you know whether you're a 10%er or a 90%er? How do you know if you've done your 10%? How do you know if you thought you were a 10%er and God thought you were a 15%er? How do you know if you still had 5% to go? How can you be sure? And another thing, how come that person doesn't have to try as hard as I do? Just because I got born with more strength, why should I expect to have to do more? So there's this confusion going on here. Confusion. He was referencing what Spalding had just described a moment ago, that there are professed Christians who say, after you've done your part, God kicks in and does the rest, but you have to do part and he does part, and between you, you get 100%. Well, they were confused, and I was confused. I've been confused on this. I can remember trying so hard to do my part. I wondered, well, what is my part? And I tried, some people told me you got to make better choices. So I tried to work at better choices. Other people told me you need to resist more than you are. You need to strengthen your resolve. You need to quote a scripture at the point of temptation. Maybe I remember carrying a little pocket New Testament around with me and thinking that maybe if I, at the right moment, I could kind of pull that thing out and it would just kind of be like a good luck charm or something. It would help me get across that crisis. I tried singing hymns at the point of temptation. I tried cold showers. I tried counting backwards from 100. I tried all kinds of ways, methods, gimmicks, whatever you might say, in order to do my part. And I discovered that I kept flopping and failing miserably. Do-it-yourself religion. I would suggest that probably the greatest problem in the Christian religion, and that would be in every church, that would be including my church, every church, is this idea that somehow we must save ourselves. Maybe we don't think we can save ourselves in terms of getting to heaven, but many of us have been confused about how much we have to do to perfect a Christ-like character. How much? See, do-it-yourself religion has a way of sneaking in very easily. The greatest symptom that I am a victim of do-it-yourself religion, the greatest indicator that I have slipped into the self-dependence rut, is the pitifully small amount of time that most of us find to spend with Jesus morning by morning and day by day. I told you last night, I think it was, about a survey that I've taken. 70 to 80% of people who attend church by filling out an anonymous survey indicate that they are faithful in church attendance, but they have little or no time for God during the week. Well, if I can't find time to spend alone with Jesus Christ on my knees in prayer and in His Word, if that's not a priority in my life, if He and I are not on regular speaking terms, there's little or no communication with God, if I do not know what it means to have a meaningful devotional life, something more than a text for the day with my hand on the doorknob, you know? Something more than somebody reading a short page of something while we all shovel food into our mouths around the table. Something more than just flipping on the station to the religious broadcast while driving and calling that my time with God. If I don't go one-on-one with Jesus, if I don't have time for Him, then regardless of what I might say, I am depending on myself. I am actually living my life independent of a personal relationship with Jesus. Wow. We've been told that it would be good for us to spend a thoughtful hour every day in contemplation of the life of Christ, and that we should especially focus on the closing scenes. A thoughtful hour. But many of us can't even find enough time. Many of us can't even find as much time to spend with Jesus as we spend with our meals. And yet Jesus compared Himself to bread. He said, I am the bread of life. Well, how much time do I spend eating the physical bread of life? And could there be any correlation? See, if I don't have time for the bread of life, I'm living my life independently of Jesus, regardless of what church I attend on the weekend. Now, I'm talking about the daily devotional life, because that's how you get to know Jesus better. You remember Mary and Martha? Martha, bless her heart, she was working for Jesus. She was trying to make a meal for Him and for the disciples and for her brother and sister. I mean, that's a good thing. I would call that church work, working for Jesus. But when she came out and made it clear that she wished Mary'd help, remember Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus, learning of Him, Jesus said to Martha, 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 you're troubled by much serving. But one thing is needful, Martha. And Mary has figured out what it is, and I don't want to take that away from her. Martha, I appreciate your desire to work for me, but Martha, there's something I want even more than your work, more than what you can do for me. Martha, I want you. I want a friendship with you. I want to commune with you. I want to fellowship with you. I want us to become closer and closer. And Mary's figured that out, Martha. Now, Martha, I'm not saying I don't want you to work for me. I'm just saying that, you know, let's stay in touch, shall we? If I don't have the time with Mary to sit at Jesus' feet, if I am substituting working for Jesus for devotional life, then I am living life apart from God. I am depending on myself. This daily devotional life is not optional. It's the whole basis of the Christian life. It is. Can you imagine someone trying to run a dairy farm without any cows or goats? Can you imagine someone trying to skydive without a parachute more than once? Can you imagine a baker without flour? Can you imagine a bank or a banker without money? Oh, you can't imagine that because that's what we do in America, I guess, is sort of bank without money. But anyway, you understand what I'm saying. In each of those examples that I just used, the most important ingredient was missing. Well, what flour is to the baker, what a dairy cow is to the dairyman, the daily devotional life and time alone with Jesus is to the Christian. It's not optional. It's the least common denominator. I cannot grow in a personal walk with Jesus without spending time with Him day by day. Can't do it. It's not optional. You don't just squeeze this in at the end of a busy week if you have a little time before you fall asleep on Friday night. No, this is a daily matter. I eat food every day, and I must eat the bread of life every day as well. Now, this angel's message that we were just looking at, I'm going to look at it again with you because there's a word in here that I want to note. It's called fornication, and we're going to look at the verse again. Another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now, this word in Scripture describes an illicit relationship outside of marriage. That's what it describes. You could boil it down this way. You could say that fornication is when two parties who are not supposed to merge, merge. All right? I could describe it to you this way. I love it when my wife makes homemade bread. I just love it. And there's nothing like coming home and walking into the house and smelling that aroma of fresh bread popping right out of the oven. You know, and I go over there and I look at it sitting there cooling, and I'm sniffing at it, and I'm thinking about how I've been told that, you know, you shouldn't put butter on hot bread. But, you know, I have to confess to you, I've put my life at risk more than once with that sort of very combination, and almost regretted it, but not quite, you know. And so anyway, sometimes I will go to have one of this, go to slice myself a piece of this fresh bread and put a little bit of butter on it, get that kind of melting down a little bit, you know, soften the center just a bit more with that butter. And Margie will say, would you like a little peanut butter or anything else? Maybe some, you know, almond butter or peanut butter. And I'll say, Margie, I can't believe I just heard you ask that question. That would be fornication. Fornication. You don't put peanut butter on top of fresh bread, a stronger flavor to drown out this wonderful taste. No, Margie, no, please, no fornication in this house. Well, maybe you don't think of that as fornication, but the point I'm trying to make is that it's the merging or attempted merging of things that aren't supposed to merge. And in our house, I don't think peanut butter should merge with fresh homemade bread that's still piping hot. I just don't. So that's my opinion. Well, theologically, there is a form of fornication called syncretism. Syncretism. Syncretism is the merging or attempted merging of two antagonistic principles or ideas that are not compatible. So that's what syncretism is. Trying to get some things together that aren't compatible. They shouldn't be trying to put them together. They don't, you know, oil and water. They don't go together. It's very difficult to mix oil and water. Well, syncretism is like that. Theologians use this word to describe a strange concoction of salvation that is based partly on works and partly on faith. These are terms that are mutually exclusive, actually. Salvation partly on works and partly on faith. In a little book entitled Selected Messages, there is this interesting comment. Some think they are committing themselves to God while there is a great deal of self-dependence. There are conscientious souls. Now, we need to be easy on these people. These are conscientious souls. These are not reprobates. These are not rebellious, hard-hearted, indifferent people. These are conscientious people. These are people who will probably attend church. They probably care a lot about the things of God, and they're conscientious. And I don't want to be too hard on them because they might end up looking too much like me. But these conscientious souls are trusting partly to God and partly to themselves. They're actually syncretists, whether they know it or not. They do not look to God to be kept by His power, but depend instead upon watchfulness against temptation, against the performance of certain duties. They got those gimmicks, you know, I was talking about a few minutes ago. You know, you strengthen your, you know, your resolve. You stiffen your backbone. You take the cold shower. You sing the hymn. You do whatever. You depend on a gimmick. They depend on some sort of watchfulness against temptation, the performance of certain duties. There are no victories in this kind of faith. Such persons are actually toiling to no purpose. Their souls are in continual bondage, and they will find no rest until their burdens are laid at the feet of Jesus. See, we're looking for Jesus in the three angels' messages. We're looking for Jesus in the book that bears His name, the revelation of Jesus. See, trusting partly to God and partly to myself would actually be spiritual fornication. Partly to God and partly to my spiritual fornication. Furthermore, consider this. Fornication is an attempt to obtain some of the fruits of marriage outside of marriage. Are you with me? Okay? Now, some of the fruits of marriage outside of marriage, that's fornication. Now, I want you to notice something in a little verse that you're familiar with, a couple verses in the book of Galatians. Notice this. The fruits of the Spirit are love, joy, peace, forbearance, which is another word for patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and even self-control is a fruit of the Spirit. Isn't that interesting? Would you say, if you look at those characteristics, would you say that those would be good descriptions of a Christ-like character? I would say so. Yeah. And did you notice that the Christ-like character was the fruit of the Spirit, not the fruit of the person? A Christ-like character is not something I produce for God. It's something that God produces in me through the power of the Holy Spirit. It is the fruit of the Spirit. Now, if I am trying to produce a Christ-like character outside of the relationship with Jesus, then I am attempting to acquire the fruits of a relationship without the relationship, and that's spiritual fornication. Spiritual fornication. Still the remnants of Babylon, even in conscientious souls who are well-intended, still part of the wine of Babylon. It is possible to be involved in Babylon even in a church that has figured out who the beast power represents. Are you hearing me? Well, studying Babylon would have to include its most famous king, Nebuchadnezzar. He was a giant king of a giant nation. At the time that he was king of the world, king of the known world. His kingdom dominated the entire planet in terms of what was populated at the time. He was a big man. He was somebody. And he thought so. And in Daniel 4, he was standing out on the veranda looking out over the city, Babylon, and he said these words. The king spoke, "Is not this great Babylon that I have built for a royal dwelling by my mighty power and for the honor of my majesty?" Whoa. King Nebuchadnezzar was a victim of do-it-yourself life. Do-it-yourself life. You know, most of us transfer fairly easily into do-it-yourself religion because most of us have been raised on do-it-yourself life. Really? Now you think about it. Even from a small child, what do? You know, look at this. Johnny learned to tie his shoe all by himself. Oh, Johnny, no kidding. You did it by yourself? I did it all by myself, yeah. Listen, would you like me to help? Would you like me to help you do the zipper on your coat? No, I'll do it all by myself. Well, Johnny, I'm so proud of you. Do it all by yourself. Oh, look at here. Mary drew this picture all by herself. Nobody helped her. Nobody. She didn't trace it. She didn't stencil it or anything. She did it all by herself. Oh, Mary, I'm so proud of you. Really? You did it all by yourself. That's great. We just reinforce this concept. All by yourself. Santa Claus tells little boys and girls, I'm going to give you goodies if you have been good. If you have behaved, if you have stayed out of trouble, if you have had self-control, self-discipline, we give you presents. But if you haven't, all bags of switches and lumps of coal. We give children allowances if they do their chores. If they don't do their chores, well, not so much allowance. At school, you can get extra credit for extra work as long as you did it all by yourself and you didn't cheat or borrow from anybody else. You need to do it all by yourself. You get what you pay for. You pay for what you get. You deserve it. You earn it. You work at it. You are responsible. You are the master of your own ship. You know what the unspoken message is in all of this? It's that charity is good to give, but it is bad to receive. Something that's a gift? Oh, no. There's a wonderful friend of ours who used to do our taxes. Her name was Ruby. And the first time she did our taxes for us, I was frustrated because when she handed them back to me, she said, there'll be no charge. And I said, Ruby, I didn't bring them to you thinking you were going to do this for free. She says, no, I want to do this for you. Now, don't give me trouble. I want to do this for you. She says, Pastor Venden, are you a legalist? She said, can you accept a gift or do you feel like you have to earn it? See, I'm doing this because I'm just grateful for what you've been sharing with us. And I just want to do this. So don't be a legalist. Well, we moved away from that town after having become very close to her. She did our taxes several times for free and I began to feel more and more indebted to her, see, because you don't accept something for nothing. That's the way we grow up. There's no free lunch. If it is, it's charity, and charity is good to give but bad to receive. That's the way we communicate. So we moved away, and I got this great idea. She lived alone, and so we bought an airplane ticket for her to come and spend a holiday week with us, and I remember her telling me on the phone, now I'm planning to pay for that ticket. I am very upset with you that you already purchased it and sent it to me because I am glad to come to your place, but I know I do your taxes and you can't afford to buy an airline ticket for me, so I'm paying for my own ticket. I said, no, I said to her, Ruby, I said, are you a legalist? Can't you accept a gracious gift? She said, oh, man. So she came and she spent a week with us. And we went to take her to the airport at the end of the week, had a great time. When we come back to our house at the end of the airport trip, our children, who were elementary school age, went to their respective rooms to whatever, to play or to whatever, and before you know it, they're both coming back. They have an envelope. Under their pillows was an envelope. Each of them had a $100 bill, and it said, now you tell your parents that unless they're legalists, this is for you to use for school clothes, and you just tell them that they can't mess with that. And I called her, and I said, Ruby. But there's something difficult about accepting a gift. See, we grow up on the notion that you have to put in some effort if you expect a benefit. You got to depend. There's some self-dependence going on here. We applaud the singers that sing, "I did it my way." We applaud them. I know the song. I mean, I can sing it. And yet, the message of the song, "I did it my way." And then after all of this, growing up on do-it-yourself life, we struggle because we're trying to pour grace theology into old wineskins. And you remember what Jesus said about old wineskins? They can't hold the new wine. The grace theology is like new wine, and it bursts the old wineskins. And it bursts them because self-made men tend to want to worship their maker. Nebuchadnezzar said, "Is not this great Babylon that I have built?" The words were barely out of his mouth. And God passed a judgment upon him. Zonk! And he became the first hippie. Did you know that? Because the Bible says that he was on grass and grew long hair. He was the first hippie. Daniel 4, while the word was still in the king's mouth, a voice fell from heaven, "King Nebuchadnezzar, the kingdom has departed from you, and they shall drive you from men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and they shall make you eat grass like oxen until you know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he chooses." God wanted Nebuchadnezzar to know who kept his heart beating. Isaiah 42:8 says, "I am the Lord. That is my name, and my glory I will not give to another." Amen. It's not about what I do. It's about what he does. And what he does is promise to work in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. No syncretism here. He says, "I will both will and do. I am the responsible party for the whole package." Philippians 2:13, "It is God who works in you both to will and do of his good pleasure." Well, if that's what he wants to do, if that's what he wants to do, what is he waiting for? What is he waiting for? You know what he's waiting for? He's waiting for us to surrender. That's what he's waiting for. But surrender is difficult for us because we are born with this independent drive. It's part of our genes and chromosomes ever since Adam and Eve blew it in Eden. Independence is just the way we are wired. It's the way we're put together. Here in America, we even celebrate Independence Day. You know, independence. We have trouble with that word, surrender. For most of us, we think of the word surrender as a bad word. Surrender is what losers do. In a war, the people who surrender are the losers. In a game, the people who surrender are the losers. And then we come along and we read in Scripture that God is looking for us to depend upon Him and to surrender to Him, and that that actually is a good thing, a good thing. It just seems to go counter to the way we think. But you know what? In the heavenly economy, much of what we think is just opposite from the way the heavenly economy goes. You know, in the heavenly economy, if you want to be the greatest, you would be what? The servant of all, right? You know, in the heavenly economy, if you cast your bread on the waters, it returns to you, see? In the heavenly economy, the first are last and the last are first. In the heavenly economy, when you surrender, you win. It's just the opposite of the way we think. Just the opposite. Many years ago, when I was a teenager, some friends of mine took me scuba diving. I wasn't certified, but they were, and we did this buddy dive so that I could learn about it. I thought it was so cool. Another world. I came home. Remember, now I'm a teenager. And it was during that time, many people understand this, there's a time in your life when as a teenager, you don't seem to think your parents are all that cool. And I was in that stage. And when you don't think your parents are all that cool, your parents feel this estrangement, and it kind of hurts them. You know, Mark Twain, I think it was, who said, when I was 14 years old, I couldn't believe how stupid my dad was. But when I became 21, I couldn't believe how much he had learned in just 7 years. Well, I was this teenager, right? And I come home from scuba diving. I say, Dad, you should try this. My friends took me out as a buddy dive, and I'll bet you they'd take you. And my dad said, oh, that wouldn't be necessary. I wouldn't want to be a burden. I said, I don't think they'd think it's a burden, Dad. Let me give them a call. He said, no, don't call. No, don't trouble them. I don't want to be a burden. I said, you know, I don't think they'll think it's a trouble. And here, I dial their number. I say, would you guys take my dad scuba diving like you did me? They said, we'd love to. That's great. I said, Dad, they said they'd love to. And my dad said, wonderful. Truth was, he didn't want to go scuba diving because he was afraid of scuba diving. But he chose to go because he wanted to bond with his teenage son, who actually offered to do something with him, you know. So we put him in a swimming pool and got the wetsuit on him and the whole bit, you know, and the tank and the regulator and that little thing you blow up, you pull on it. If in an emergency, you pull a little cord and it goes... And it will float you out of trouble. And the fins and the mask and the whole thing. Put him in the swimming pool. He said, see? Piece of cake, Dad. Piece of cake. He said, yeah, this isn't too bad. He sat on the bottom of the pool blowing bubbles. And yeah, that's not bad. So the next day we took him to off the shore of San Diego, California. Happened that the night before it had stormed. And so the water was murky and the waves were large. But we said, not to worry, Dad, not to worry. Because you have the mask on your face, no salt gets in your eyes. You have the regulator in your mouth, no water's going to get you. You can breathe air, it's not going to be a problem. And you know, we're just going to walk out, we'll go under the turbulence of those waves, and we'll be fine. It'll be another world, you'll just love it. So we started walking out into the ocean together. And as we were walking out into the ocean, I turned and looked at my dad, and he looked at me, and I saw behind the glass, I saw terror in his eyes. And he began shaking his head vigorously from side to side, like, no, not now, not ever. Forget this. This is nonsense. I'm not going to do this. So we said, okay, Dad, we're close enough to shore. You just go ahead and go back. But we're going to dive, and we'll see you in 30 or 40 minutes. So he turned around, and we went out, and we went under. When we came back, my dad, still in his wetsuit, still with a tank on his back, was lying on the beach on his back with the fins sticking up right where the waves were coming up and crashing onto his feet. And he's lying there like this. He looked kind of like a beached whale with the black outfit and all of that, you know. And I came up to him and I looked down in his face. I said, Dad, what are you doing? He said, I thought I was going to die. I said, what do you mean, thought you were going to die? He said, I turned around to swim in and there was a riptide of some kind coming out. Some kind of undercurrent. It was kind of like getting on a treadmill, an exercise thing. And he said, the harder I swam, the less distance I made, and the shore just kept standing off for me, and I'm working to try and get there, and I can't get there, I can't get there. And he said, I started panicking. Well, when you panic, you don't think clearly. It never occurred to him to pull on the little cord, float that thing out and just float until he got out of the current and then come on into shore. Never occurred to him when you're panicked. So he just worked like a, you know, and he was running on adrenaline. And adrenaline only lasts so long. And finally he runs out of adrenaline. And now he can't even swim anymore. And he said, I thought I was going to die. I thought, so this is how I'm going to die. I'm going to sink to the bottom of the ocean. And I'm going to breathe the air in my tank until it runs out. And then I'm going to drown. And tomorrow in the newspaper in San Diego, it's going to say, Morris Venden died while trying to bond with his son offshore in San Diego. And he said he actually gave up and sank all the way to the bottom of the ocean. And as his knees hit the bottom of the ocean, he realized he was only chest deep in water. And he crawled out and flopped, and that's how he found him. But you see, when he surrendered, when he gave up on himself, he won. He won. And that's the way it is with Jesus. Nebuchadnezzar had to lose everything before he surrendered and acknowledged his need. He had to come to the end of his own resources. It is incredible how stubborn some of us are. It's incredible how much we will put up with before giving up. I once did arm wrestling with a classmate in college. He was way stronger than me. He had grown up as a block layer and a surfer. I mean, you think about that. Surfer and a block layer. This guy had muscles on his muscles. I was a fool to even think I was going to go up against him. But I remember trying. I thought, I've got to try. I worked so hard. People were watching us. They said, Lee, your face is so red. I can't believe how red your face is. And I'm working, and I get like here, and then I come back up a little bit, and I start to think I'm going to make some progress, and then I try again. And finally, I mean, I'm hyperventilating. And crash, I lose. The next morning, when I was brushing my teeth, I looked in the mirror and I had red polka dots all over my face. Seriously, little red, little like measles. And I thought, what's gone wrong? I thought, I have some incurable disease. I'm probably going to die. I probably won't even graduate from college. And I went to the nurse's station and I said, weirdness. I woke up. I've got all this stuff all over me. What do you think it is? And she said, I don't have any idea. I've never seen anything like it. I said, oh man, it's probably serious. Probably very serious. She says, well, you know, as I look at it, it looks almost like you were straining and your blood pushed out into the outer capillaries and then they closed up and it couldn't get back in. That's what it looks like. Have you ever strained recently? Oh, have I ever strained? We are stubborn about surrendering and giving control to Jesus. We are sick. We are drunk on the wine of Babylon, which is self-dependence. And it doesn't matter what denomination you belong to, this is a problem for everyone. You notice it said all nations drink of this stuff. They all do. Nebuchadnezzar had to lose everything before he surrendered and acknowledged his need. He did not understand that surrender was the way to win. But God was patient with him, and he's patient with us. Aren't you glad he's patient with us? Long-suffering. And in the end, he prays one of the most tremendous prayers in all the Bible. Have you read it recently? It's an awesome prayer. Daniel 4. Notice who gets the credit and the glory in this prayer. At the end of the time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up my eyes to heaven and my understanding returned to me. There's something about looking to Jesus that gives you new understanding. And I blessed the Most High and I praised and honored him who lives forever, for his dominion is an everlasting dominion and his kingdom is from generation to generation. All the people of the earth are nothing compared to him. He has the power to do as he pleases among the angels of heaven and with those who live on earth. No one can stop him or challenge him, saying, what do you mean by doing these things? And now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and glorify the King of heaven because everything he does is right and all his ways are just. And those who walk in pride, he is able to humble. Well, you know, quite frankly, I'm thankful that he's able to humble. You know, last night, Jim Gelly was talking with a group of us over here, and he said, sometimes I almost thank God for a weakness that forces me to realize I can't do it all. Sometimes. It's a blessing in disguise, perhaps, huh? A blessing in disguise. Well, if God could bring that heathen king to his senses, he can do something for you and for me. And that's good news. That is good news. And one day we're going to join that group of people who, according to Revelation 15:3, are going to sing together, great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty, just and true are your ways, O King of saints. I want you to pray with me, so let's just bow our heads. Lord Jesus, please, please keep doing the good work that you've begun in our lives. Crowd this self out of us. Replace it with yourself. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Enable us to recognize that surrender is the way to win. Surrender is the way to victory. That you are safe to surrender to. We thank you for offering us that invitation. We thank you for your patience and your long suffering. We thank you that you haven't written us off, even though we're slow learners. And we thank you that you promised to complete the work you've begun. In Jesus' name. Amen.